There are an infinite number of visual effects that you can do in OpenGL. But back when I started graphics programming, I was very excited to learn and implement as much as possible. So I wish I had a video to tell me about all of the techniques that are out there, so I can look at them later on my own, but most importantly, try to find easy ones to implement some of them in my engine. So today, I will take you through all of the visual effects and techniques that I know of, and I could find. So even if you are just a beginner at graphics programming, or very advanced, you will find something new and interesting to implement or learn. I will compress my 5 years of experience into this video, so promise me to pay attention because there will be lots of useful things to be learned, like easy to implement gimmicks, and improvements or alternatives to the classic deferred rendering pipeline. To showcase, I will be using my own 3D engine or my Minecraft clone where possible. The effects will be split into geometry, lights, shadows, and special effects. I will also talk about things that are not exactly effects, but are very worth for you to know about. And trust me, some of them are insanely smart. They will not be in any particular order to keep the video interesting. So let's start with geometry. Let's start with something nice, like wave simulations. Now for me at least, I don't really care if the simulation is physically accurate. I just want it to look good. To implement this, you have to make your water plane out of many triangles and shift their positions to simulate the waves. There is another easier way to achieve some water movement, but we'll talk about it later during the light section. This article can be found in the book GPU Gems by Nvidia. And if you want more the good learning resources, you can find them on my Discord server. What about something easy to implement for everyone? World curvature could be a nice gimmick for your engine. All you need to do is apply this formula after multiplying with the view matrix, but before the projection matrix, and you are done. Skeleton animations are quite a scary topic, but there are good resources online like the one on learnopengine.com or this video series by Cinematrix. Basically, you add bones to your mesh, and each vertex is moved by some bones. Animations are defined by keyframes, and to animate, you have to interpolate between two frames. It doesn't sound that difficult, but you have to get the mass right, and it takes some time to wrap your head around it. But if you are advanced, using the mentioned tutorials, I definitely think that you can achieve it. Decals are some details that are applied on top of geometry. They can just be another texture projected, or even be geometry themselves. Now you could of course just add another object to the scene, but since these details are small and many, engines have special optimizations for them. You can find an example in this Doom Eternal renderer study. Volumetric rendering refers to rendering things like clouds or smoke, for example. A way to render clouds is to store them in a three-dimensional matrix and then cast rays through that matrix. Then, depending on how dense are the clouds in that area, you make them more or less visible. I will talk about another example of volumetric rendering later. Let's talk about some optimizations. Geometry cooling. The GPU will throw away any triangle that is not visible to the end user. If you have a big open world, however, even the fast operation of checking if the triangle is outside the view frustum is expensive for millions of triangles. So, what if you could chunk objects together and throw away many of them at once? Frustum cooling checks if the bounding box of an object intersects with your view frustum. If not, it can be thrown away. This has to be implemented by you on the CPU or maybe on the GPU using compute if you are chatty enough. There are also some other algorithms like Octris that partition the world to, again, faster determine what objects are inside the view frustum or not. We all love a nice high poly model, except we don't because it takes time to render. But it looks so nice up close. Well, you could just have multiple versions of the same model with different triangle count and use the appropriate one depending on how far it's from you. Unreal Engine has a system called Nanite that automatically does that for all of the geometry on the screen, and they can render an impressive number of triangles, simply because they actually reduce them at runtime, without compromising on visual aspects. There is a talk on YouTube about their system if you are curious. Now, what about getting too close to geometry? You can use tessellation shaders to increase the model's triangle count. This doesn't always help with handmade 3D models, but with procedurally generated geometry, they can essentially bring infinite resolution. Tessellation shaders could also be used for displacement mapping, which uses the texture to actually modify the geometry, and also, why not, for water simulations. Geometry shaders are a special type of shaders that allow you to generate geometry on the GPU. They sit after the vertex and tessellation shaders, and before the fragment shader. Essentially, the geometry shader takes a vertex and spits back anything from another vertex to multiple vertexes. You can also compute things like the normals here. I wouldn't recommend using them, because they are quite slow in general, and you can do a lot of things in the vertex shader. For example, in my last Minecraft clone, I send only the face position and type, and the vertex shader computes both the geometry and the normals. You probably know by now that sending a lot of data to the GPU is not very efficient. In the article about the Doom Eternal rendering, we can see that ID Engine 7 has a massive buffer for its entire geometry, and then, using some compute shaders, calculates what it needs to be drawn in that scene using a single draw call. To do this, you also need to have access to all of the materials in your shader, and I'll show you how to do that a little later. A quick riddle for you. What seems easy and natural, but is a pain to describe mathematically? Yes, it is rotations. Quaternions are used to describe rotations in 3D engines. While they might seem intimidating, you don't have to understand all of the math behind them to use them. You can just use the existing functions implemented in the GLM, for example. Drawing realistic loads or hair is something more difficult than we think it is. They are both soft materials that have to be simulated in order to be realistic. Sometimes, these simulations can take place on the GPU. Even if you choose not to simulate hair, you need to render many curved lines in order for it to look good. You can't just render some geometry made of triangles, because that won't look very realistic. Finally, while wind is not necessarily something that you can see, it can affect many things like the grass or the smoke in the game. And a real-time accurate simulation of the wind should probably be implemented on the GPU. In this article about rendering in God of War, the author decided to start with how the wind is simulated, because many systems in the game use that system, and it is also the first thing that happens in each frame. Okay, now I move on to lighting. We will skip the very basic Phong shading model and go straight to normal mapping. Normal mapping allows the artist to add normal information in a texture, like adding color. So even though the geometry may be flat, the normal at the surface will point in different directions, adding details. Now to do this, you need tangent and bitangent information, and besides what you can find on learnopenchunk.com, there are several optimized ways of doing this actually. My way, which is not the best, but very easy, is to just compute the tangent and bitangent in the shader. Next, we find again something very easy to implement. You can use textures for more things than just color information. For example, you can have a specular texture to specify the specular component of the materials. Speaking of easy to implement bright lights, lens flare are just 2D textures that are displayed on the screen, and the effect looks very nice. Cinematrix has a nice tutorial and even goes into occlusion curves to determine how visible is the sun. If you are too good for this, however, there are also advanced techniques that simulate the lens flare more realistically, starting from the scene's light information, and the result looks incredible. Well, we can't talk about the sun's lens flare without talking about the skybox. And if this bores you, I'll let you know that there are dynamic ways of generating a skybox using some atmospheric refraction formulas that also take into account the atmospheric density and stuff. Now, if you blend your result with the skybox based on the fragment distance from the viewer, you will get fog, a very easy to implement effect, and Thin Matrix has again a nice tutorial on this. Another easy to implement effect is chromatic aberration. This happens when light passes through a lens, and to implement it, you just have to take your image and shift the color channel slightly. I increase the power of the shift the further the pixel is from the center of the screen, and I recommend you to also bias it based on the fragment's distance from the viewer. You can have a modern rendering engine without physically based rendering, because I say so. PBR basically means applying some fancy mathematical formulas that I don't understand to get nice looking graphics. This is called a rendering equation, and it describes how light behaves in real life. Copying the formulas from normalpointgen.com is not that difficult, but it is not enough. This is just a specular and diffuse light, and you still need ambient light to get nice looking metallic and shiny materials. And that part turns out to be difficult. The easiest way of achieving some ambient light is to use image-based lighting with the skybox. This just means reflecting the skybox information on the object. This is nice, but works well only for outdoor scenes. If you work inside a building, you have to change the skybox to sample from. And in between, maybe blend between the two skyboxes. What I'm describing here starts to look like an approximation of light probes, and we'll get there in a second. First, I want to mention this article that I found, because it is a very easy addition to your PBR pipeline. Basically, using a pipeline similar to what you would get after making the PBR tutorial on learnopenchunk.com, this article proposes a better ambient light calculation model that accounts for secondary light bounces with the model itself. The result looks better in my opinion, and it is just some extra mass operation, so it is not expensive at all. Okay, getting back to ambient light. One of the most difficult things to implement in a rasterization engine is probably the global illumination. It however makes your PBR scene look even better than it already is. Imagine that you have only one light source, like here. The things in shadow are basically almost completely black. But in real life, it would look more like this. You can see now how important global illumination is. Things like light bounces are also included in the global illumination system. I'm not an expert in global illumination, but the first thing that you probably have to learn is spherical harmonics. They are defined on the surface of a sphere, and they can approximate the light information of the entire skybox with just 27 values. They are basically a Fourier transform, but on a sphere surface. So, you are basically storing the global light into the frequency domain, and this works very well because the global light doesn't have high frequency features. Now, in order to capture the light information in different parts of the scene, light probes can be used. They are placed in many places in the scene to capture the light information, and they use spherical harmonics or image-based lighting. The details are of course a lot more complicated than that. There is also a technique called screen space global illumination. Whenever you hear screen space, that means that this technique uses only the information available on the screen to enhance the visual aspect. This is why in the case of global illumination, this effect doesn't look very nice when the camera is moving. Finally, everyone is talking nowadays about ray tracing. So I'll just mention that using ray tracing, you can get very good global illumination information. If you're curious how the special ray tracing hardware works, RT cores accelerate bounding volume hierarchy, which is basically a data structure to hold geometry and make the ray casting process faster. Okay, let's look at something else. What about this wax sculpture? You can tell that it is made of wax, but take a moment to think about why it is that. Well, it is because of light subsurface scatter. It basically means that some light enters the material and leaves it at a different part of the object. While rendering wax is something that isn't common, skin is also a translucent material, and if you want to render realistic skin, you need to do something similar. Okay, now we get back to volumetric rendering. God rays are basically these powerful lights that create rays because they hit dust in the atmosphere. And they can look very nice in combination with smoke. Now this effect can get difficult to implement, but there are also some easy screen space techniques that also look nice. Wait, this is not bump mapping that we have already covered. It is parallax mapping. It keeps the geometry the same, but it samples the texture from slightly different coordinates to generate this 3D effect. If you look at the object at a 90 degree angle, you will be able to see that it is actually flat. Now you might say that this is not used nowadays, but it actually is sometimes. The Dynamics now in God of War, for example, is actually implementing using parallax mapping. Next you get to reflections, and we all know what they are. The easiest way to achieve them is using image-based lighting, as I mentioned earlier. This, however, only gives skybox reflections, as expected, so an advanced solution is to create multiple omnidirectional maps in the scene and use the appropriate one for each object. This just means rendering a 360 view of your scene from multiple places. A good but also easy solution is to use screen space reflections. This means reflecting the information already on the screen or the information from the last frame. This also means that at the edge of the screen, there will be less reflections. To reduce this problem, you can render the screen slightly bigger than what you show to the user. I recommend you this video if you want to try it yourself. After reflection comes refraction. And refraction is when light bends after crossing the border between different mediums. This is easy to implement with a single object and the skybox. It is also not very difficult to implement with water, as explained in this tutorial. I also used it in my Minecraft clone, and basically all I do is that I render everything under the water into a texture. Then I apply that texture to my water, but I shift it by some random amounts. For this, I use what is called a DUDV texture. And with this, I also cover the second, easier way of achieving moving water of this video. After refraction comes diffraction. Yes, it exists, and it basically is light bending around corners. Now this creates nice patterns on microscopic surfaces like a CD. So if you want to render a shiny physically accurate CD in your engine, you can find out how in the GPU Gems Volume 1, Chapter 8. Ambient occlusion is in a way an approximation of global illumination. Basically, surfaces where there is a lot of geometry like corners should be darker. The easiest implementation is screen space ambient occlusion, and all it does is to look at the geometry near every point to see how crowded with geometry that place is. But there are also some other improved versions that are also screen space. Horizon-based ambient occlusion is one of them, and I have a full video on it. It is similar, but it looks at the slope of the terrain. Probably, the most impressive version that I found is the screen space directional occlusion. This implementation also uses spherical harmonics, and it encodes both a direction and an ambient occlusion. To calculate the final occlusion, you have to dot its result with the light's direction. You can see from this demo that you can almost get shadows with this effect, which is insane since its complexity only scales with the screen size. One thing to be mentioned is that most screen space techniques can be computed at half the screen resolution. Ambient occlusion, in particular, looks almost the same at half the screen size, and this is how I also implemented it. Bloom is an effect that happens when there is too much light in a point, and it bleeds into the surrounding pixels. All you need to do is to isolate the bright light spots, blur the result, and add it on top of your original image. Now you can use the implementation of LearnOpenGL.com, but that one is not that good. The Chernoff has a nice video explaining why. You essentially have to blur the bloom image multiple times and scale it down and back up. We will also reuse this scale down information later, but for now, just keep in mind that if you want to implement this, you can't read from an image and write to another MIP from the same image. You'll need two buffers to scale down and up your image. Bloom works best, however, with high dynamic range. Think of a scenario where you have a dark cave, a well-lit environment, and the sun. Well, you only have values from 0 to 255 to encode your luminosity, so how can you encode all of these values? Well, you can apply a function to the light intensity that slowly approaches 255, but never exceeds it. LearnOpenGL.com has an example, and I'll give you a way better one in a minute. Don't get scared by the frame buffer stuff, you don't need it. Now, our solution is not that good yet. We just basically reduce the light information in our scheme, but you still can't see much. Well, usually we don't need to look both at bright and dark surfaces at the same time. Even our eyes are adapted differently to see in the light or dark, so the exposure parameter controls what part of the light range we want to view. All of this makes this nice scene possible, because we are viewing the bright sun, the other darker objects are just black. This scene looks cinematic because movie cameras also have exposure due to the same limitations. Here the exposure is determined automatically, and to do that, you can't just look at the brightest pixel on the screen, because just a single pixel could mess up your entire scene. You have to look at an average luminosity. And for this, you can use the downsample texture that you created earlier while blurring your bloom texture. Finally, for a better high dynamic range function, you can use the ISS tone mapping function. I'll just provide a link for you to copy it. This function is also used in the film industry, and it is made to be accurate to how light behaves in real life. What is nice about it is the fact that it makes very bright lights turn white, as it happens in real life. The result looks very nice. Now, I mentioned cinematic scene, but there is nothing more cinematic than the depth of field effect. Essentially, this simulates the autofocus effect for objects that are, well, out of focus. There are multiple variations of depth of field. Bokeh is an example that produces this nice geometry light shapes on the lens, and I think that it looks very nice and cinematic. Finally, color grading or color correction is a simple filter that influences the final colors of the scene. If you want your scene to look a certain way, there are many parameters to tweak, like the skybox, or the materials, or the colors, or the exposure. With color grading, you can just take a screenshot of the game, take it into a special color grading software like DaVinci, then, after your scene looks exactly how you want it, export those settings into Photoshop to generate this lookup table. This is basically a 3D matrix, where for each color value, you'll have another output color. I know it seems strange to have an entire section dedicated to shadows, but they are one of the most difficult things to do in computer graphics. And I know I already said that about global illumination, but I don't know that much about that. So, basic shadows. They are implemented by rendering the scene from the light's point of view. This allows you to essentially see what the light can see. Then, comparing some depth values, you can determine if a pixel is in shadow or not. Then, using a technique called percentage close filtering, which is literally averaging multiple neighboring shadow values, you are essentially blurring your result. You can get soft shadows. You can also bias how soft the shadows are depending on how far they are casted, because this is how it happens in real life. There are many interesting optimizations, and even one that includes the dreaded shader branching. But first, I want to talk about geometry. In the Doom render studies, it is mentioned that the static geometry is only rendered once, with only the dynamic geometry rendered on top each frame. I also do that in my engine. This in a way allows me to bake the shadows. Also, it is worth noting that many people store 3D shadows not in cube maps, but in custom formats. Now, about shadow optimizations and improvement. This article talks about some PCF optimizations. One of them is to take less random samples in a disk pattern, but rotate that disk for each pixel. It also says to first take a small number of samples, and if they all have the same value, consider that fragment fully in shadow or light. And yes, that means using an if in the shader, and that is because it is not always allowed to use ifs in shaders. It's more complicated, so if you are a beginner, please don't even think about this sort of optimizations. You are very likely to make false assumptions. I will also mention that this video explains shadows very well and shows a trick to drastically reduce Peter Panning by biasing it with the dot of the light and normal. The next common option to get soft shadows is called variance shadow mapping. This uses statistics that I can't understand to calculate the shadows, and it has the advantage that you can blur the texture as a pre-process effect to get softer shadows. It has its own visual artifact though, called light bleeding, but it is quite fast on the uphand. Most problems with shadow mapping come from the fact that the shadow map can't usually be big enough. Rectilinear texture wrapping for adaptive shadow mapping is a technique that morphs the shadow texture to take up more space in the places that are more relevant. This is insane and the result looks so good in my opinion. Speaking of shadow map resolution, how can you render a very big shadow map, like for the sun, in a big open world? Two similar techniques, called cascaded shadow maps or parallel split shadow maps, with the former producing better looking results. Basically, it splits the view into multiple regions and assign a shadow map for each. In this way, more precision is designated for close objects. There are many more shadow techniques if you make a quick search on the web, including screen space of shadows. Finally, we get to special effects. Before that, if you like this video and would like to support me, please subscribe and share this video to someone who needs it. It helps me a lot. And if you want to help me even more, you can check out my Steam game that will come out very soon or even join my channel. Now pay attention because I have some more interesting things to show. The first one is transparency, and it could have an entire section dedicated to it. The easiest way to achieve transparency is not transparency, but rather just discard fragments that have an alpha equal to 0. This can get you this problem, and if it happens, you just have to fill your transparent texture space with the color of the neighboring pixels, like I'm doing here in Photoshop. But do this programmatically, and of course, leave the alpha channel to 0. Now, for real transparency, the naive way of doing it is to first draw your opaque geometry, then sort your transparent geometry so you always draw it back to front. This works if you don't have interleaving triangles, and if your geometry is easy to store and sort. I do this in my Minecraft clone. As a bonus, if you have all of your geometry sorted, you can draw your opaque geometry close to further, because the GPU can quickly discard and optimize fragments that don't pass the depth test. Now, for more complicated scenes, there are many techniques called order-independent transparency, because they allow you to render objects in any order, and all of them are difficult. Some are approximate, and others are exact. The approximate ones don't give the real result, but are cheaper. A rather easy exact implementation is depth peel. This is done in multiple steps, and it basically allows you to reconstruct the layers of transparency to in the end combine all of them in the right order. The limitations are that for each step you need to render all of the transparent geometry, and you need as many steps as there are transparent layers. It works by rendering all of the geometry first, then again by using the depth to only render the geometry under the first step, essentially peeling the first layer, and so on. A more difficult and inexact but efficient technique is called weighted blending. That is explained in learnopengl.com. What about exact order implementation technique that can be also fast? Yeah! In the OpenGL programming guidebook, I found this technique that holds a big linked list on the GPU and sorts the transparent fragments per pixel. And it doesn't even use compute shaders, though you definitely can do that. Yeah, insane. While not a graphical effect, rendering many textures is something that has to be done, and it is not straightforward. Don't worry, there is a very easy fix, but let's look at some techniques. In Doom 2016, they used the Mega Texture, that has all of the necessary information. This is like a more advanced texture atlas. The problem with this is that you can't properly do filtering, like mip maps, and sometimes neighboring textures can bleed into the next block. There are fixes for this, but they are complicated and there is no need for them because now we have bindless textures. Bindless textures can be accessed through a 64-bit number and you can send it to the shader however you want. As I mentioned before, in Doom Eternal, they do their light pass with only one draw call, and this is possible only because of bindless resources. In my own engine, a deferred renderer, I render the material ID into a texture in the geometry stage, and later I sample the material data in the light pass. I'll talk more about deferred rendering later. I also have a video on bindless textures if you are interested. Anti-aliasing basically is a technique that reduces pixelated visual artifacts. The simplest way to achieve anti-aliasing is called super sample anti-aliasing. It works by just simply rendering the image at a higher resolution and then squishing it back into the native resolution. This is of course horrible for performance, and it is literally the opposite of what many engines do, as you will see shortly. So, the first viable option is called multi-sample anti-aliasing. This is actually done by the GPU for you. Whenever you draw a triangle, the GPU will check if a pixel is inside the triangle or not. And with MSAA, it will do that check several times, but each time with the pixel center shifted very slightly. Finally, the average result will give us less jagged edges. Aliasing artifacts can however also occur when sampling textures, so fast approximate anti-aliasing was created. It is a post-process effect that looks at the final image and tries programmatically to find edges artifacts and to eliminate them. It is also fast, as the name suggests. Another clever technique of solving visual artifacts is temporal anti-aliasing. It solves the problem of determining the correct pixel color in the time domain by doing something similar to MSAA but over multiple frames. You can apply similar temporal techniques to other areas like shadows. To implement, however, TAA, you need something called a velocity buffer. And it is a buffer that stores how each pixel moves from the last frame. Yeah, that doesn't sound fun to implement, but it will help us with another effect later. Finally, we saw that we can remove aliasing programmatically after the image has been rendered using FXAA. This means that we can do something better using AI. And this is where deep learning supersampling comes into place. This is actually more of an optimization than just an anti-aliasing technology, because it allows you to render the scene at a lower resolution and upscale it. The frame rate improvements with this are amazing. The only thing is that you need a modern graphics card to run it. DLSS is something Nvidia specific, and it is already implemented by the graphics vendor. But AMD also has their own version called FSR. Okay, now all of these anti-aliasing techniques also work well with adaptive resolution. For an action game like Doom Eternal, it is very important to not lose FPS. Adaptive resolution makes the final image smaller to drastically reduce the computation cost, and then it rescales it to the window size. Doom 2016 and Doom Eternal also have this implemented, and yes, that means that the image quality drops. However, anti-aliasing techniques mitigate this problem, and their TSAA implementation is very good, so sometimes you don't even realize that you are playing at a lower resolution. LensDirt. While you might say that is not something interesting, this is just a texture applied on top of the screen, well, not quite. This is usually combined with other lens type effects, like depth of field or lens flare, or maybe you could try to combine it with bloom or even god rays if you are creative. Essentially, any bright light that hits the objective can trigger this effect, so even a bright light shining directly at the camera could trigger it. While some people don't like it, motion blur is a nice effect. To implement it, however, you need something called a velocity buffer, and that thing is probably not that straightforward to implement. But if you have a velocity buffer, you can also implement other temporal based effects like temporal anti-aliasing. Post-processing effects can make your game look so nice. Look at Celeste. The screen warps and all, and there are things like blur or chromatic aberration. This looks so nice. I tried implementing similar things using ShaderToy. Searching for radially wrapped image shader online, for example, gave me this formula directly from Unity. And then I played around with it to get this. If you don't understand how to get to things like this, I will make a mask for game development soon, so subscribe to not miss that out. Finally, let's talk about deferred rendering. And yes, there are alternatives to it. Many beginners think that any modern rendering pipeline has to be deferred, but Doom Eternal, for example, isn't. We'll see in a second how. So, deferred rendering basically means that you are not doing your light calculations right away, but rather later. You first render your geometry information into something called a G-buffer, that holds position and normals, and then compute the light calculations. This is useful because when light calculations are expensive, overdraw can slow down your game. Overdraw is when you draw an object on top of another. You don't want to waste time coloring pixels that will be later completely covered by another object. It is important for the G-buffer to be as small as possible because, being as big as the screen size, moving that much memory around can easily slow down your game. You however need that information anyway, for some effects like screen sprays, ambient occlusion. Now, in my engine, I have a deferred renderer, and I also defer the materials. My objects have a lot of material data, including color, emissiveness, material data, and so on. So instead of rendering all of that for every object, I just write the material ID and read the data later. I however also need to send the UV derivatives information in the G-buffer in order to correctly sample the materials. The deferred rendering also comes with its own disadvantages, like the fact that you can't do MSAA on it. Now, if there are still too many right sources, there are techniques like tile deferred rendering or cluster deferred shading that splits the screen into tiles to basically group the lights. The former splitting the screen into 2D tiles, while the second one into 3D frustum volumes. So, how can you not pay the overdraw cost and not use a deferred renderer? For this, you can use a Z-prepass. Basically, just render only the depth of your screen. No color is computed. Then you render your scene again normally, but change the depth equation to GL equals. This means that only relevant fragments will be calculated. There is even forward plus rendering, also called cluster forward shading, that is basically forward rendering, but you also split the scene into 3D clusters to group the lights. Now, I know that I have forgot about something that you know of, so let me know in the comment section so we can all learn even more. I might even make a part 2 if I get enough ideas. See you next time!